Welcome to Hoops High, Chicago's leader in youth-produced sports broadcasting and youth media education. Hoops High is produced by high school students learning the skills of professional broadcasting. Hoops High is the flagship program of Free Spirit Media and is made possible in partnership with After School Matters, the Chicago Public Schools, and Chicago Access Network Television. We hope you enjoy the show.
Tiffany Moore, and I'm here at Westinghouse for the HoopsHIGH Free Throw Classic. Today we have the Magics versus the Celtics. Please stay tuned for more HoopsHIGH.
Sneed.
And we're here at Westinghouse for the first annual Free Throw Classic where the Celtics take on the Magic. So, Q, who you think is going to have a better advantage in the game today?
Let's see. I think it's just going to be a pretty far hard game today. You know, both teams, well, the Celtics are missing some of their key players. And I think the Magics is just going to come out and play hard, man, just give it all they got. And the same thing goes for the Celtics.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out, like, before the game, like, how the Celtics was going to do without one of their key players, number 7, DeJuan Wright, who's in Florida for 2 weeks. So, which means he's probably going to miss the next game, too. I'm just trying to see how they're going to recuperate without him. And it looks like they only have 8 people. So, yeah.
Yeah, they're gonna play good, man. Everybody got a role on the team, and they're just gonna come out and they're gonna play hard.
Who you think gonna be their key players?
I think Darius Mason gonna come out. He gonna play hard. He always do his thing every game. You know, I think he gonna come out and do his thing this time too, as well as Ricky.
How you feel about Ricky playing center, like for the jump ball?
it's everybody gotta adjust sometimes. You feel me? You know, to do what the team gotta need them to do. But as you see, he won the tip anyway.
Yeah, that was a great way to battle for it. Ricky, he's actually playing center. That's a good position for him. And what's that, number 8, Jahar Muhammad? Number 6, Jahar Muhammad for the 3. Number 8 for the Magic.
Yeah, so you see Frog bringing up the ball.
He's actually the one who won the game in triple overtime against the Bulls.
Yes.
Off his own miss off the front of the rim and got the rebound.
That was a great game.
That was actually the first time in Hoopsville history that we ever had triple overtime. Jahar Muhammad with the ball again, drives, and it's good.
Oh.
That's 5 points already.
He's doing his thing.
He's going off. It looks like that he's not going to have that they're not going to have a problem with missing DeJuan Wright.
No, not at all, man. I don't think so.
See, number 1, Darryl Ivy knocks the ball out of bounds. Number 9, T.O. with the shot and it's missed. T.O. on a drive again, and it's good. T.O. Campos with the basket off the glass.
This ain't football.
but basketball is a pretty good sport, though. So, yeah. Frog with the rebound. John Muhammad with another basket at 7. He has all 7 points.
He's doing his thing, man. He playing. I told you, man. They going to come out here and they going to battle hard. They going to play and do their part.
Yes, indeed. Number 3, David Marion with the missed shot. Number 7, Tavares Sanders takes it back up. Off the missed rebound is good.
Yes, yeah, so we got the Celtics out here playing the Magic. The Celtics is undefeated in the HoopsHIGH tournament.
Yes. Out of bounds on number 6, Jahar Muhammad. Number 3, David Marion with the ball. He's walking it up the court. He's double teamed. Number 5 for the Celtics. Darius Mason with the steal and the easy basket on the other end. Q, how you feel about these turnovers thus far, like in the game? Just like the
they just got to slow them down if they want to stay in the game, because the Celtics, that's a good team, man. That's all they're going to do. They're going to pressure. They're going to make you get that ball up. And if you give it up, they're going to come down. They're going to get their points in.
T.O. with the missed three. And they save. Number three, David Marion with the shot, and it's no good. Number one, Devin Weathers with the ball. He gets the rebound. He gives it to number nine, T.O. T.O. gets to David. David for three, and it's good.
Nice. Good shot. Good shot. Now the game is tied. Score is now 9-9.
With 12 minutes and 45 seconds left in the quarter. Jahai Muhammad with the ball. Passes it to number five. Ricky Battles with the ball now. At number five, Darius Mason with the ball. He gives it back to Jahai. Jahai gives it back to Darius. Jahai with the ball. Jahai on the drive, and it's no good.
His first miss of the game.
Yes. Rebound by number seven, Tavares Sanders. Number nine, T.O. Campus with the ball. Gives it to David. T.O. for three, and it's no good. Ricky Battles with the rebound.
The Magic's just shooting, Joe. They just pulling it.
Yeah, when they was warming up, they was hitting a lot of threes. I don't know what's going on now.
Yeah, more definitely. You are watching Hoops High. Remember, you can watch Hoops High every Saturday at 8 o'clock on CAN TV, Channel 19, for all the hottest high school action around.
Oh, Devin is fouled pretty hard. See the little trooper Jabari born and almost ran
got
over.
Knocked over. Shout out to Jabari.
To the line for the Magic is number one, Devin Weathers. Devin for his first free throw, and it's no good. He kind of shoot his free throws like D-Rose.
Yeah, you know, they call him D-Rose, too. He look like him a little bit.
No. Devin for a second free throw, and it's no good. Ricky Battles with the rebound. He's pushing the ball up the court now. And it's blocked by number seven, Tavares Sanders.
HoopsHIGH is produced by high school students learning to be professional broadcasters. All of the camera work, announcing, and everything else is done by young students.
Number seven, Tavares Sanders with the ball. He passes it to number one, Devin Weathers. Devin Weathers with the ball, pushing up the court. Devin for three, and it's no good. Ricky Battles with the rebound. Passes it to number one, Daryl Ivey. Daryl Ivey passes it back to Ricky Battles. Ricky Battles for the step up two, and it's good.
Great shot. Great shot.
Yes. Number three, David Marion is fouled by number one, Daryl Ivey. Subbing into the game for the Magics is number five, Charles Bates. For number three, David Marion. Devin Weathers with the ball now. He's pushing the ball up the court.
Free Spirit Media strives to give students a voice and is associated with True Star Magazine. You can check them out at www.truestar.com. Remember, True Star is where teens speak the truth. Check out the Hoops Hop column in True Star Magazine.
Tavares Sanders with the ball in his off the backboard. He gets his own rebound and he puts it up and it's good. Score is 11-11.
This is a great game so far, man. It looks like it's going to be a pretty high scoring game.
Yes, already the score is 11-11 with 9 minutes and 25 seconds left. Number one, Daryl Ivey misses his first three. Charles Bates with the ball. Charles on the drive, and he loses it. Number nine, T.O. gets the ball. T.O. finds Charles for three, and it's good. Charles Bates with a three-point shot.
The Magic has finally taken the lead. Score is now 14-11.
Yes. Ricky Battles with the ball. He passes it to Jahad. Jahad passes it to Darius. Darius passes it back to Jahad. Jahad for three, and it's no good. Ricky Battles with the rebound. Ricky on a drive. Ricky is fouled by number seven, Tavares Sanders.
Now with that being said, we're going to talk to our sideline reporter, Tiffany Moore.
So you're here watching the basketball game. Do you play any sports yourself? And if so, what sport do you play? And are you good?
I play water polo. I play goalie. And I'm pretty good, yeah.
Okay, thank you so much for your time and enjoy the game.
Thanks, Tiffany, for that great sideline report. Number 9, T.O. with the ball. He pushes it up the court. He tries to pass it to number 4, who actually just subbed in, Terry Al Boyd. And he's out of bounds on T.O. Ricky Battles with the ball. He passes Darius Mason. Darius Mason gets the ball to Ricky Battles. Is that Daryl Gant with the ball? He passes it to number 2. Javonte Ramsey. Ricky Battles with the ball now. Ricky Battles is calling the play. He's selling the ISO. He got a little man on him, Devin Weathers. Number 4. Daryl Gant with the pull-up shot and it's no good. Ricky Battles with another rebound. Pass it to Javonte. Javonte for 3, and it's no good. Number 7, Tavares Sanders with the ball. Gives it to number 1, Devin Weathers. Devin pushing the ball up the court. Devin on, oh! He rolled his ankle. Hey, no, that looked like it hurt a lot. Travel hit was called. Ricky Battles with the ball. He's looking at the coach. He's actually playing power forward right now. And he's actually running the point guard position. So, Ricky Battles with the ball. Ricky Battles for 3. And it's good. Ricky, with that 3, Ricky Battles gives the Celtics a 2-point lead. Score 16-14 with 6 minutes and 19 seconds left. The ball is stolen by Javonte Ramsey. Javonte gives it to Ricky. Ricky on the drive. And it's no good. Daryl Gant with the rebound. And it's stripped out of his hand, off his leg, out of bounds. Great D by number 9, T.O. Campus.
Yes. HoopsHIGH is the flag program of Free Spirit Media and is run in partnership with After School Matter, the Chicago Public Schools, and CAN TV. This is a team effort all around. We are grateful for our partners who make this possible.
Charles Bates with the ball. He passed it to number 1, Devin Weathers. Devin Weathers just called the play. Devin Weathers passes to Charles Bates. Charles Bates, pump fake. Charles Bates on the drive.
And he's dribbling on the floor.
That's a good way not to hold the ball. Charles Bates wide open for 3, and it's no good.
Not this time, big dog.
T.O. with the ball. T.O. Oh, T.O. fouls him, and the ball goes in. Number 5, Darius Mason with the layup. Can I see a replay of that?
Count it.
You can see Darius Mason on the drive. It's good. Off the glass. Subbed into the game for the Celtics is number 8, Joshua Roberts. He's a freshman. Number 1, Devin Weathers with the ball. He's pushing up the court. He gives it to David. David for 3, and it's no good.
That was a horrible shot.
Yes. He had a lot of personal saddle. Ricky Battles with the ball. Ricky Battles step pull up 3, and it's no good. Devin Weathers with the great rebound. Devin pushing the ball up the court. He gets number 3, David Marion. David
passes
it to Chucky. Chucky misses it.
Nah, a little too much pass.
Fouled. He had to throw it in, because if he didn't, it was going to be out of bounds. Charles Bates to the line.
Keep up with the game action and HoopsHIGH crew. With Twitter, just search HoopsHIGH FSM and follow us.
Yes, you can keep up with me, Michael Ingram, at solo_kid8, and you can follow Q at
One Trey Crazy.
Chucky misses his first free throw. Chucky to the line for a second free throw. And it's good. Charles Bates with 4 points.
The score is now 18-15, Celtics away.
Yes. Celtics with the turnover. Number 4, Terry Al Boyd loses the ball. Charles Bates with the ball. He gives it to Devin Weathers. Devin Weathers for 3. And it's good. He shoots just like Rose.
Great shot.
He shoots just like Rose.
Score is now tied 18-18.
With 3 minutes and 5 seconds left in the first half. Ricky Battles with the ball. He's looking for someone to pass to. Passes to number 4. Terry Al. I'm sorry. Yeah, he passes to number 4. Terry Al Boyd. Ricky Bowers holding the ball. Trying to waste time. I think they're doing a great job of just monitoring the clock. So, what do you think they're going to do, Q?
I think they. You talking about as far as the entire game or you just that specific play?
In the half, just so on the way just to end the half.
Just in the, they going to finish playing hard, man. That's the only thing they can do, just keep playing hard, as you see. This Magic with a great pass.
Steven Smith with the easy layup. Ricky Battles with the ball. He passes to number 4. Terry, our boy. Ricky Battles with the ball. Ricky to Terry. Terry back to Ricky. Jahad Muhammad with the ball. Number 8, Joshua Smith with the ball. Joshua Roberts with the ball.
Great hustle. Yes.
Ricky Battles with the ball. Ricky gives it to number 4. Terry, our boy, and he misses. Derek Ham with the rebound.
Great way to get big.
Foul. Yes, foul. Getting ready to sub into the game for the Magics is number 8, Chaz Jackson. Number 10, Zajan Wilkins. Daryl Grant to the line for his first free throw. Subbing back into the game for the Celtics is number 5, Darius Mason. For number 3, Ricky Battles. Daryl Grant getting ready to shoot a second free throw. And it's good. Zajan with the ball. He passed it to Devin. Devin pushing the ball up the court. Devin passes it to David. And it's stolen by number 5, Darius Mason. Jahad Muhammad with the ball. He's pushing up the court. And he's fouled by number 1, Devin Weathers.
Great hustle by Darius, man.
Yeah, it's a great way to get down there and get the ball, do dirty work. Jahad Muhammad with the ball, a.k.a. Frog.
Jahad just called a play.
It's 15 seconds left on the clock. Darius Mason with the ball. He passed it back to Jahad. Jahad passed it back to Darius. Gives it to number 4, Terry. Darius with the ball. Pull up 3 and it's no good. Daryl with the rebound and it's no good.
Great hustle. At the end of the half, the score is 21-20. Celtics way.
How do you feel about the game thus far, Ken?
It's going pretty good. Like I said at the beginning of the game, man, both teams are going to come out here and they're going to play hard. They're going to give it their all. How you feel about it, Mike?
I mean, it's a pretty high-scoring game, you know, 21-20. It's a lot of threes going, a lot of threes being shot, a lot of layups and ones or whatnot. I think that they should, just lay low on shooting all the threes, you feel me?
Yeah, most definitely. I think both teams just need to play a little bit of harder defense if they want to go on and run away with the game. Yeah. If not, it's just going to be score for score.
I think that it's going to be a bar burner again, you know, with them just, you know, you feel me? High scoring game, probably go down to.
Yeah. Yes, indeed. Now, with that being said, we're going to talk to our sideline reporter, Tiffany Moore.
Hi, I'm Tiffany Moore, and I'm here with Coach Williams. So, Coach, it's 21-20 with your lead. How do you feel your boys are playing today?
Right now, it's not looking good. They're getting too many second chance shots. We're letting them get inside, and they're making easy layups. So we got to do a better job on defense.
So this is our first Hoops High tournament. So how do you feel like your players have gotten out of this? What do you feel like they've received out of this tournament?
Well, I mean, we're always stressing basketball. We're always teaching basketball. So this tournament, you know, Summer League is for to develop our kids to get more better. So they're getting a lot out of this. So this is the chance to make mistakes. Summer League, that's what Summer League is for.
This is a summer league, but so during regular season, do you feel like your players will be in any tournaments or anything like that to keep the momentum going with their playing?
Well, yeah, we're going to play in a lot of Thanksgiving, Christmas tournament and things like that. Hopefully, we'll be already prepared for the season, so we shouldn't have to play in too many more tournaments to develop. These guys know how to play basketball. They've been together for 4 years, so what we're doing is teaching the younger players that's coming in now.
Thank you so much for your time, and good luck on your game. Now I'm going to toss it to PSAs.
Yo, you're rocking with Amari Stoudemire, and you're watching Hoops High. Watch it or watch nothing.
Behind the scenes of Hoops High, it's more than interviews and replays. The crew contributes 110% in setup and production.
While we have fun, we are also very serious about getting the job done.
We have the opportunity to work with big companies such as Nike and to meet current and future NBA stars. We are Hoops High.
This is Derrick Rose from the Chicago Bulls, and you're watching Hoops High.
Yes, yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're back with more Hoops High. I'm Michael Ingram.
And I'm Quavonte Sweet.
And we're here at Westinghouse for the first annual Hoops High Free Throw Classic, where the Celtics are beating the Magics by one. Score is 21-20. This game thus far is a pretty good game. You know, bar burner. I think it's going to come down to be a bar burner. What do you think, Q?
Yes, indeed. I think if either team just, you feel me, just play defense a little bit, they'll take off on the offensive side, because they'll probably get more steals and more fast break, easy points. And that'll be game right there.
As you can see right there, the Magic's coach and the Magic's. It's going to be a pretty great game.
Yes, I'm just excited to see what's going to happen in the second half, what team going to come out here and play defense and do what they got to do to get a W.
Yeah, I'm interested to see some more highlights. I want to see it done. I don't care if it's a basic two-hand or one-hand or what. I just want to see it done.
That's what's up. What you going to do after the game, Mark?
Probably, what's today, Tuesday? Well, my church has started vacation Bible school, so I should be there at 5. But besides that, I may just go home and just work out, do a little basketball, football, and get ready for my track meet. That's Thursday.
That's what's up.
Shout out to everybody on the Hoops High crew. Miss Shelton, Miss Eugene, Debari Border, Tamia Tribble, Logan Lawson Parks, Jawan, Twinkie, a.k.a. Jermaine, my main man Q, Lamont Press, all y'all. I see y'all there. Cheyenne Banks, Charles Carter. Yeah. Shout out to Jeff McCarter, Sean Cave. Yeah. Back to the game. Number 6, Jahai Muhammad with the ball. He's looking for someone to pass to. Passing number 5, Darius Mason. Jahai Muhammad with the ball. And it's stolen by number 9, T.O. T.O. loses the ball. I think T.O. was going to try.
Great hustle, though. Great hustle, man. That's what I'm looking for, you know? They come out here and play defense. One team going to pull away. That's all.
I think with that steal, I think that the Celtics are going to do a more good job than Jahai would do.
That's a great shot, man.
I think Jahai has like 10 right now.
Yes, indeed. That's exactly right.
He actually scored the first 7 points for the Celtics. I'm sorry. Jahai with the steal. He passed number 3, Ricky Battles. Is Ricky going to dunk it? Ricky for the layup, and he's fouled.
Great move. Great move to the basket.
Yes, indeed.
As you see that, it turned the defense up a little bit. Now the score is 24-20. And if they keep playing like that, they're going to take off.
Mm-hmm. Jahai knocking down the big 3 to push his team to a 4-point lead. Ricky to the Battles for his first free throw. Ricky with the shot, and it's no good. Ricky misses his first free throw. As you can see, the coach of the Celtics. Ricky to the line for a second free throw, and it's good. Gives his team a 5-point lead, scores 25-20. David with the ball, and it's carelessly thrown back in bounds. Tavares with the ball, and it's stolen by number 5, Darius Mason. And it's off Ricky Battles. Ricky Battles gets it back. Ricky Battles gives it to Jahai Muhammad. Jahai for 3, and it's good.
He is on fire. Jahai doing his thing.
with 13 points.
Yes, the PSAs, drama, and documentaries that you've seen between breaks on Hoops High are produced by Free Spirit Media students at North Lundell College Prep High School, the Gary Cole Muse Center, and the Powerhouse High. We hope that you enjoy the stories and the messages that we young people are sharing with you.
Jihad is doing a pretty good job. You know, when he went into triple overtime with the Bulls, he only had 4 points.
Yes, indeed.
And the fourth point in his second basket, which gave him 4 points, was actually the game winner once again.
True. As you see them all coming out of break.
Yes. That is
the huddle, I mean, to say.
1, 2, 3, defense.
Yeah, the score is now 28-20, Celtics way, as you see. The last play, they turned the ball. Well, the Magic has turned the ball over.
Magic getting ready to inbound the ball. Number one, David Marion loses the ball.
Yes, as you see, the defense just turned up. TTU.
TTU. Two turned up. Chaz getting ready to inbound the ball. Chad passes it to Tavares. Tavares passes it to David. David, the ball is served by number six, Jahad Muhammad. Jahad to the basket is good.
What's going on? Jahad. Somebody ate their Wheaties today.
Yes, Jahad with 15 points in the game.
Ocho. Tavares. Ocho.
Jahad is doing a pretty good job being able to step up when one of their captains and one of their best players, number seven, DeJuan White, isn't here. Chaz with the ball. Chaz is pushing the ball up the court. Chaz to the basket. Coast to coast and is good.
Yes.
Chaz gets the ball off the rebound, off the inbound, I'm sorry, and pushes it coast to coast. He's a pretty fast kid, man.
Yeah, he got down.
Jahad with the rebound. Yes. And he passes back in. Chaz did a pretty good job of speeding down court and getting the basket. Oh,
looked like a carry.
Yeah, it looked like
great,
a carry.
Great D.
T.O. got a little bit of carry. Jahad to the basket, which was a. Oh, it looked like he traveled.
I thought he was finna call travel too.
It looked like he took like 3 steps.
Yeah. The big man was calling for the oop, though. I think Jahad should have threw that, man. I would have jumped out of my seat if he got that oop.
Yeah, I would have called the game if I was a ref if you'd have ooped it. Jahad to the line for his first free throw, and he's good.
Yes. He now has 16 points.
Wow. Look at the one of the coaches in the stands in a white one, in a white shirt, saying what would have happened if Jahad would have ooped it.
Yes, indeed. Please check out the Free Spirit Media website at www.freespiritmedia.com. Or check us out on YouTube. Search for Free Spirit Media to view our YouTube channels.
Devin with the previous wild layup, and it was missed. Darius with the missed rebound, and it's good. Jahad with the open three, and it's good. Is that like 20?
That's now 19 points.
Jahad has 19 points, a game high. David tries to come back with three, and it's missed. Ricky Bowers with the ball. Ricky Bowers, behind the back, Ricky Bowers. Ricky Bowers passes it to big man number 10, there again.
Great ball move.
Yeah, it's a great way to touch it. I'm sorry, number two, Javonte Ramsey gets the assist. Devin Weathers with the ball. He's pushing the ball up the court. Devin to the basket, and it's no good. Big man Darryl Gant with the rebound.
Great hustle by both teams for the try to grab the rebound.
Yes, and this Magic's way. Subbing into the game for the Celtics is number one, Daryl Ivey, and number four, Terry Al Boyd.
Yes, I guess Coach G gave him I don't know what he said, but at halftime, they done turned it up.
Yes. After that. I think Devin just got carried away. He just got away with the credit, with the carry. He's called timeout.
As you see the great D by Ricky Bowers to make the Magic call the timeout. Score is now 37-22. Celtics way.
What do you think the Celtics need to do to come? Magic need to do to come back.
Magic just needs to take their time on offense, man, and get a need to get a couple of people, get the big man back. You know, have a couple, have the guards up top, to bring the ball up and just continue to play well.
If DeJuan was here, how do you think the game would go?
It'd just be just the same, man. They'll still be playing hard. He'll be another couple of points on the board, couple of steals, couple of rebounds that he can contribute to doing. But they'll still be playing the same way.
What do you want to see before the game ends?
I just want to see both teams continue to play, man. I just want to see a good game.
I want to see a dunk. You know, the big man number 10, Derek Campbell's dunking.
Yes, did you see a coach?
Yes. Number 8, Joshua Roberts is called for the foul.
Don't forget to stay tuned for Free Spirit Media News at the end of the broadcast. It comes on at 9:50 every Saturday. Learn about what's going on in Chicago and find out the latest and most important issues with the teams.
That's David Marion with the great save. David to the basket, floater, and it's good. David Marion with the great floater. Getting ready to sub into the game is number 5, Charles Bates. And number 4, Terry Alboy. I'm tripping. Number 4, Stephen Smith, and number 5, Charles Bates. I just had a brain fart.
You must ain't eat your Wheaties this morning.
I ate my Wheaties, but I'm looking at the Celtics roster instead of the Magic's roster. And subbing in for number 3, David Marion, and number 8. Chaz Jackson, the coach is calling for the Magics to run 2-3 zone. Number 1 for the Celtics. Driving with the mystery. T.O. to the basket. T.O. with the layup, and it's no good. Charles with the rebound is good. Charles Bates with the great rebound and put back up. He's a junior. Number 1, Daryl Ivey. Pass it to Ricky Badger. Ricky Badger passes number 4 to our boy, and he's fouled.
T.O. going for another steal, man, trying to get his team back in this game, man.
Yeah. Subbing into this game.
Yeah. With that being said, we're going to talk to our sideline reporter, Tiffany Moore.
Hi, I'm Tiffany Moore, and I'm here with Kwan. So, Kwan, I understand you're a junior and you play football. So, how are you preparing yourself for the fall?
I practice hard, and then after practices, I still run like an extra mile or two. And then I stay inside and I drink a lot of water.
So you said that you run an extra after the mile. So do you feel like that extra that you do makes you a better player? And how do you feel like your performance shows out on the field?
I think it's like self-motivation. So when I run the extra mile or so, I'm bettering myself. Like, I do it for me. Like, it's not just a team thing. I can better myself even after practice, so.
Thank you so much for your time. Now back to our announcers.
Thanks, Tiffany, for that great sideline report. As on the play right there, number 8, Joshua with the block. Joshua with the rebound and his tip back in. Joshua Roberts, a freshman. T.O. with the ball. He passes number 5, Charles Bates. Charles on the drive and is off the side of the backboard. Number 2, Javante Ramsey with the ball. And it's stolen by number 1, Devin Weathers. Devin with the ball. Devin spin. Devin off the backboard and is no good. Javante with the ball again. Javante passes to number 4, Terrell Boyd. Terrell Boyd passes to Joshua. And it's out of bounds on number 1, Devin Weathers. So, yeah, this is a pretty good game. Number 1, Daryl Ivey with the ball. Daryl passes to Darius. Darius passes it back to Daryl. Daryl passes it back to Darius. Darius on a drive, and it's no good. He gets his own rebound and tips, and it's no good. Charles Bates with the great rebound. He's looking for someone to pass to. He's just going to push it up the court. Charles with the ball, he passes to T.O. T.O. on the drive, and he kicks it out to number 10.
The big man.
Yes, the big man.
If you just can't seem to get enough of Hoops High, friend us on Facebook. Get to know the crew and what's going on into every Hoops High production.
Yes, Zadrian Wilkins with the great ball, with a great layup. David Marion. I'm sorry. Devin Weathers with the pass and got a bounce off the big fellas, off the big fella's belly. Number 10, Xavier Wilkins. Number 1, Dura Ivy with the ball. He's walking the ball up the court, looking for someone to pass to, passes to Darius. Darius passes it to Terry. Terry passes it back to Darius. Darius on the drive, takes it back out to Javonte. Javonte for three, and it's no good.
Oh!
Over the back.
He calls for over the back, and he was tackled in the air by the big fella's back.
That was a great hustle, though, by Darius, man, to go up and get that rebound.
Yes. I don't think that should have been over the back. It should have been a foul.
It was over the back.
He jumped up and got it. I mean, like, he had to catch himself coming up there.
But you cannot jump over somebody. Mm-hmm.
Timeout, Magic's way. Score is 39-28.
With 4 minutes and 31 seconds left in the game.
Yes. The person that has time for the Celtics is Jahad Muhammad with 19.
Yes. You see them breaking out their huddle, getting ready to do their thing. They just got the Magic over here. Coach is talking to them, telling them what they need to do. Just try to stay in this game and hopefully come back and win this game.
Yes. This is a Jahad Muhammad is really going off. He's one of the two players today. Him and number 3, Ricky Bowers. Ricky Bowers contributing to the rebounds. Inbounding the ball. Number 7, Tavares. Tavares shot throws off his back and it doesn't work out. Joshua with the shot. And it's good. Number 8, Joshua Roberts with the great shot, with the great mid range. David is wide open and he throws it back. Oh, wow. Devin with the ball. He's pushing the ball up the court like D. Rose would. He passes it to Charles. Charles with the ball. David is calling for the ball. Is David going to shoot three? No, he passes it to Tavares and it's a turnover. Both players just ran into each other. Yeah. Number 5, Charles Basin. Number 1, Devin Weathers. Jahad for three, and it's no good.
Not this time. Exactly.
Joshua Roberts with the rebound, and it's good.
We know we are not always perfect, but we are working hard, and we are always learning. We thank you for your support and your encouragement.
Jahad on a drive, and he's fouled. Score is 43-28, Celtics way.
Jahad was on that bench, and he got a little cold.
He came out. Jahad to the line for a striking free throw. Ricky Battle subbing into the game for number 1, Daryl Ivey. Jahad to the line for a second free throw. And it's good.
Yeah, that's now 20 points.
All while we were coming in to get ready and work. On the first person in the gym was Jahad getting up shots. So yeah. I think he really deserves to get this 20 points. He's pushing hard for it. David with the ball. He passes to Jahad. Jahad back.
Bad pass.
Darius and Jahad with a great defense. Tavares with the ball. He's called for a travel.
He's spinning. He's playing football, man. He's running.
He's spinning. I don't get how they didn't catch it the first time. He actually switched pivots. Somebody would. Oh.
As you see, Charles with the ball, bringing the ball up.
Yes, Charles with the hesitation crossover.
Yes. Want to see more Hoops High games? Now you can see a full game on iHigh. Go to www.ihigh.com/hoopshigh to see games from the past or stream live from your homes.
Yes, and if you want to see more of me, you can also go to iHigh. Me back in the day when I had a fro. You might get a chance to probably see Q.
Yeah, most definitely. On the football field, you feel me? Doing my thing.
Well, considering I only played 2 games, you can probably see me too. I probably wasn't doing nothing. Maybe just warming the bench face. Ricky Battles on the drive. Ricky Battles for the layup, and Ricky Battles airballs. Wait, how do you airball a layup? A free throw, a three, a mid-range, I might understand, but a layup? Really? Ricky Battles with the great defense. Passing number six, Jahad. Jahad with the rebound. Oh, he misses.
Jahad is off. Muhammad. He is off, man.
Yes, Joshua Roberts with the
put him back on the bench, coach. Game over anyway.
Score is 46-28.
As the clock is winding down with 44 seconds left in the game.
Yes. I think they're just going to call the game. I don't know if they're going to let them play through it or not.
Yeah, they're just going to let the clock finish running, man, while they're bringing the ball up, and it's going to be a game anyway.
Yeah. Devin on his B-roll status. Is he going to pass the ball or is he going to shoot three? T.O. with the three. T.O. misses. Big man Sajan Wilkins gets the rebound, and it's no good. Joshua calling for the ball. Ricky Bowers is just going to dribble the game out. I think that this is a great game. I think this was a great game. Scores, the final score is 46-28.
Yes, indeed. Get my 2 Chainz. Truck.
You see Jimmy Free Throw Sanders was trying to stick D on one of the Westinghouse on the Celtics player.
Yes, indeed. Great game, man. Like I said at the halftime, man, if the Celtics going to turn it up on defense, then they going to win. They'll pull away.
Yes, they both had a good game. Well, the Celtics did.
I just realized and just thought about it. The Magic only scored 7 points in the second half.
Yeah, and it was 16 minutes. Rather. In 16 minutes.
That's sad.
It is. I think that maybe if they had us playing, you know, it'd be a good thing. You know, maybe they would have won if they had us.
Yes, indeed. That was a great game, though, Mike. You enjoyed it?
I really enjoyed it. I actually want to see a dunk or something. You know, get me happy up out of my physique, you know. Yeah. You know.
You wish you could dunk?
I could actually dunk on the 6-3 rim.
Yeah. Well, with that being said, we're going to talk to our sideline reporter, Tiffany.
Hi, I'm Tiffany, and I'm here with Jahad. So, Jahad, you are the player of the game again. And how does that feel again?
It don't feel like nothing. It just feel like I was just playing basketball.
So, with just playing basketball, I mean, like, do you feel like you've grown at all from what you used to be or anything like that?
Yeah, I developed my shot.
So, how much does this team mean to you, and how much do you feel like you contribute to your team and your team plays off of you?
I feel like I bring energy to the team, and I mean, like, it's not just my team, it's our team. We've been since freshman year, like, it's our team.
So, do you think that unity is, like, a really big, important thing on your team, or is it, like, the star players do their thing and the rest just follows?
No, it's unity and loyalty. You see how we swing the ball. Everybody got to do something. Everybody got to be in a certain place so everything else can happen.
Okay, well, thank you so much, and congratulations on being player of the game. Catch us every Saturday at 8 p.m. on CAN TV Channel 19. Stay tuned for more Hoops High.
Here Ivy passes it back to Ricky Bowers. Ricky Bowers for the step up two, and it's good. That's David Marion with the great save. David to the basket, floater, and it's good. Ball. I mean, T.O. Oh, T.O. fouls him, and the ball goes in. T.O. on the drive, and he kicks it out to number 10.
The big man.
Darius with the missed rebound, and it's good.
Jahad
with the open three, and it's good. Off the backboard. He gets his own rebound and he puts it up and it's good. Here Ivy passes it back to Ricky Bowers. Ricky Bowers for the step up two and it's good. T.O. on the drive again and it's good. Number 5 for the Celtics. Bowers gives it to Jahad Muhammad. Jahad for three and it's good.
He is on fire. Jahad doing his thing.
You can watch Hoops High on CAN TV Channel 19 every Saturday at 8 p.m. Please visit www.hoopshigh.org to learn more. Hoops High and Free Spirit Media would like to thank our sponsors. We are grateful for their support in making our mission of youth media education and opportunity possible.
Hoops High is family, communication.
Enjoy it.
Hoops High is
astounding, creativity,
commitment.
Hoops High is exciting, meaningful.
Hoops High is
technology,
spirit,
a community. Hoops High is home, love, dedication,
inspired,
probably never was exposed to it, they probably would have never have done it, but it's something that you see that interests people a lot.
I never worked with a camera, you know, it was my first time learning about a camera, you know, zooming in, zooming out. It was real good experience for me, you know. I think it changed a lot in me too. It changed my how I think, and it changed like some I like to do in life.
When I get older, I want to be some type of actor. So being in this classroom really helped me out, really exercise my ability to act.
We shooting it and we shoot it off like what we done been through, and like people get to see it and they watching it and they liking it.
Like young kids in the community can do stuff that's like worth some type of value.
Meet Jaden, a 16-year-old from Chicago. He likes reading, playing basketball, and daydreaming. As one of 75 million youth in America, he is the future of our country. But today, Jaden's future is uncertain. A new economy is evolving as Jaden tries to find his way in a school system where more than 42% of students drop out and even more fall behind. For Jaden and others like him, the future looks grim. But there is hope. Youth media programs connect with kids like Jaden, moving them from discouragement toward opportunity through the power of communication. Jaden learns about journalism, technology, and culture. He spends his time engaged at school, in youth centers, and at libraries. He discovers how to observe the world around him and share his own stories. He becomes one of more than 10,000 teens involved in the Chicago Youth Voices Network, a collection of innovative programs that come together with a bold vision to reach more people like Jaden, to transform education, and to shape the health of our city. Together, the network gives vision to the journalists, artists, engineers, and leaders of our future. One story, poem, film, blog post, one youth at a time.
I like him, but I'm just not ready.
Man, what's her problem? Why she don't want to have sex with me? Come on, man, let's just do it. I mean, what's the problem?
Do you have a condom?
No, but we can still do it.
Boy, do you know what can happen? If we have unprotected sex, I can get an STD, or maybe I can get pregnant.
I don't care, as long as I get what's between those legs.
I'm not sure.
Man, you need to make up your mind. Call me when you're ready.
Dad?
Yes?
Where do babies come from anyhow?
Why, mothers bring them into the world.
But why do mothers bring them?
Johnny, by the grace of heaven, mothers are the only ones who know how to bring babies into the world.
How
How did we all learn about sex?
By doing it.
Trial and error.
Yeah, they say you learn by your mistakes.
My sexual health education was not very good, and I don't mean to like put Carrie on the spot, but like there was no standard in Chicago, just like there is no standard in Illinois, and there's no standard across the nation.
Students in my class see a vaginal birth, they see a cesarean birth, they watch people talk about how it's affected their life once they become a teen parent. We also go the other route where I spend a lot of time showing them visual pictures of genital herpes, genital warts, like chlamydia, gonorrhea. How does that affect you orally?
The sexual education was like, you know, we watch a tape of a lady giving birth, and they explain to the boys how to put a condom on, and the girls about birth control. Sexual education in the high school that I attended was very, like, somewhat straightforward, but not enough straightforward because there were a lot of, you know, students having sex.
I wasn't really thinking about having sex, so I wasn't taking that serious. But they did talk about it, but they didn't go deep into it for the ones that were having sex at the time.
It depends on the genuality of the teacher. If a teacher just comes in and they're saying, you know, don't have sex, don't do this, don't do that, and they're not engaging the conversation on why you shouldn't do it, then it's probably not gonna be as proactive as possible.
We played, we was very goofy, and I don't think it reached a lot of kids. I know it didn't reach a lot of kids, so.
They really don't even give you a choice. They like say, this is what you should do, this is what you have to do if this happened.
Just wasn't even effective at all. Because kids still, at the end of the day, was gonna do what they wanna do. And some of them didn't even make the right decisions.
It's their choice, like, it's their own personal choice. Sex education don't play no part in anybody's sex. Anybody's sex life, like why they start having sex.
It's just stuff I'm finding out that I could have learned through sex education, but I didn't.
You know, seeing more youth that are certified to be sex educators and start these, you know, peer educations in their own school or in their own community.
I think sex ed could be better if it was brought to the children's attention early on in life.
I think that the teachers should go more in depth with the conversations in sex ed, and they should have better materials and more funding, maybe more funding for the materials.
It was another way that they could have reached the children in their community and to aware them of what's to come behind having unprotected sex.
Try giving individual support to one another and just getting on their side, just seeing how their day went. It can all be better.
Yeah, sex education should address things outside of high school. There are a lot of reasons why teens become sexually active. Like, most girls don't have self-esteem, the lack of love, and that's why most girls want to become pregnant, because they don't feel love.
Just could just be more, on a friend-based level, like, y'all seen that? Don't be doing that, y'all. That ain't, list some facts behind it. Tell the real reason, the real factors behind it. Like, you know, most of them girls be insecure in them videos. Most of them girls only do it because of money. They're not happy with that.
I definitely think that the media influences choices that youth make. Absolutely. As far as sex education and how you can incorporate the media, I think it's important to bring those elements into the classroom. Bring in the videos of the boys calling the girls bitches and, you know, of the girls being half naked and walking around with her body out, you know. Yeah, bring those things in there. I think that exposing them to it, but letting them know that that's not the only way, it's not the norm, I think that's more effective than just telling them, oh, don't look at the video, or just letting them think that that's all there is to it. So yeah, I definitely think it influences them.
Yeah, the media influenced all that with dealing with sex. Sex sales, I remember when I was like a little girl and videos coming out, I used to be trying to be the person just popping and stuff, dancing and all that. And I was like no older than 8, so. And you know, the society is becoming, is getting more effective. And the generations, unfortunately, are getting worse.
We need to see changes in our sex education classes. More discussion about the real factors behind what influences teen sexual choices, such as peers and family support.
More individual support with education addressing the emotional aspects of teen sexual decision making.
Discussion about understanding the media and how to resist the negative messages about sexuality and body image.
Learning about these things and respecting young people's individual choices, I think, is the most effective.
But just not
thought
you said you
love
me.
Man, your baby ain't my father.
Okay, my baby needs to pop. You need to be here.
I want to step up because my father wasn't there for me, and I don't want my child to grow up fatherless. I'm ready.
More than half of all youth incarcerated for criminal acts lived in one-parent families as children.
Step up.
My bottle.
I don't know where your bottle is.
Man, Joe, I see my girl walk down the street with another man. I'm gonna beat it like my father used to do my mother, man.
That's
mine. Man, Joe, what you doing with this man, Joe? Man. You know what, man?
3 to 4 million women are abused each year.
Approximately 3.3 million children witness abuse between their parents each year.
Yo, what's up? Javonte Austin, high school sensation. You know, rookie in the NBA, and I'm still trying to get my high school diploma. I don't know what's wrong, man. It's just the league, they just need me they just want me in the NBA. I still ain't got my high school diploma. But for now, y'all finna see how I work out and how I made it. The road to stardom.
Okay, so who can tell me anything about what we have here about relevance? Anybody?
Giovanni.
reliability, relying on me, you know what I'm saying, to win the game, which they need to do.
Okay.
So rely on me.
I see where you're going with that. And yeah. I think actually reliability talks about the author's ability to be a credible source. But I see what you're saying. I see you trying to take that to a different spectrum. And I like that. I think that's good.
Hi, we're once again with Gio, Austin, and North Lando College Prep. How's it going? How are you doing?
What's up, man? What's up?
So, how does it feel to be the NBA player trying to, you know, get his degree still?
What's up, lady? How y'all doing? But it's like, man, you know what I'm saying? I just been in high school, you know. Got this Nike deal, you know what I'm saying? Damn, I got this Nike deal. You know, Nike cleats coming to a store near you. You know what I'm saying? I got this Swag Nation deal, you know, for the casual, you know what I'm saying? You know, just trying to make it out, you know, do what I gotta do.
I can't believe what I'm hearing. Giovanni Austin is talking about leaving high school, going directly into the NBA. First of all, his education comes first. Now, of course, he's dumb in school. Well, I shouldn't use that word dumb, but he is kind of slow. But he's even slower if he thinks that he can go straight to the NBA and bypass high school, bypass college. He knows how important his education is. He knows how his mother feels about it. He knows how his father feels about it. And he knows how I feel about it as a mentor and as a coach. This is ridiculous. I can't believe he's even thinking about it. I tell you what, he better get that out of his head right now. He's a very talented player, don't get me wrong, but education comes first.
I miss everybody. You know, the women, of course. Some of the teachers, like, you know, the gym teacher. Lunch teachers, you know, them. I'm gonna miss all of them.
Oh, yeah. It's the reason.
I got this game. We play the Bulls tonight in my hometown. Yeah, I'm ready. I'm gonna play against Rose, and I'm gonna show them what I'm about. Show them, man, how I get down. That's right. Yeah, man. Oh, I injured my leg, man. Doctor said I might be out for 2-3 months. I don't know what I'm gonna do, man. I don't know, man. I'm going to the doctor immediately, though. All right?
I'm be turning all these heads at the game tonight. Shortybed.com.
75% of teenagers will have had sex by the time they are 20.
Girl, where you going?
To the game. You like my makeup?
Yeah, I guess.
I'm gonna get too many shorties numbers. Nightmare.
First of all, you got on too much makeup, and you need to get your priorities straight. Boys is not the only thing in life.
Girl, you tripping.
U.S. teenagers are more than likely to have sex before the age of 15.
This is the female student mentor class. I really think you would like it here. It's where girls help other girls build their self-esteem.
Hello, my name is Latoya Thomas. I'm a junior at North Lawndale College Prep.
My name is Lamar Allen. I am a junior at NLCP, and I'm currently on my way to be a senior.
Hello, my name is Deborah Powell. I'm a junior at North Lawndale College Prep.
The teacher that make me smile would be Miss Ryan.
Miss Borden.
Mr. Wolf.
It's just her personality. She just real hip, and then she be singing these rap songs, and she be sounding so white, so it'd be so funny to me.
Because she's out of the box, like, everything she does is unpredictable.
He brings smiles to my face when, you know, like, just his nerdiness, you know, bringing us comfort makes me smile.
When I'm smiling, I feel joy in my heart.
A time when I was upset, smiling really took away the negative because it made me forget about all my problems. All I thought about was being happy at that time.
When I was mad, smiling would take away the negative feeling because if I'm smiling, I just don't even thinking about what made me mad. It may come back, but then I've been to forget what I was mad about.
I think smiling will help me because senior year, there's gonna be a lot of process that we're gonna have to go through. So smiling really will help me get my mind off the stress and basically just enjoy my last year in high school.
Smiling will help me continue through my senior year by keeping out all the negative peers that I have and just thinking positive thoughts and always keeping a smile on my face.
Smiling will help me through senior year just by, you know, forgetting the negative. Senior year will bring a lot of stress. Smiling will help me get over the stress and proceed.
When I have problems, I think of my little sister Smile because it's different. She makes me laugh all the time, even when I'm the angriest.
My sister Smile will be the most that I think of. And just her coming telling me that she got something new, you know, made her smile. Her smile was like full of life. It was like full of joy. Like nothing can go wrong or break a smile.
I would have to say the smile that I think about would be my babies. His smile is real big and it's like he do a little dance when he smile. And so his cheeks get real, real big and then his eyes get real little.
What is your name?
Are you there?
Yes, I'm here. What's up?
How's your day going?
It's going pretty good, just a little tired. What about you?
I'm doing okay. Wish I was there with you.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Am I going to be able to see you?
When do you want to see me?
Tonight downtown at the park.
Okay. At what time?
7:30. I'll be there waiting for you.
Hey.
money, money in the cars, cars in the clothes. I suppose I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful. I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful. I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful. Yeah, I want things to go my way, but as of late, a lot on sideways. And my mother tried to run away from home, but I left something in the car, and so I caught her in the driveway. And she cried to me, so I cried too. And my stomach was soaking wet, she only 5'2". And 48 hours all before I showed up and brought $1,000 worth of drinks and got pulled up. Damn, my reality just set in. And even when the phantoms leased, them wanna get in. I do a lot of things hoping I never had to fit in. So trying to keep up with my progress is like a dead end. My girl love me, my heart beats slow. And right now the tour bus is looking like a freak show. And life changed for us every single week, so it's good. But I know this ain't the peak though, cause I want the money, money in the cars, cars in the clothes. I suppose I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful. I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful. I just wanna be, I just wanna be successful.
Am I being followed? Will I be harassed? Oh, not him again.
Hey.
Let me go.
I mean, hey, why you gotta act all like that for? I don't just try to get your name. Keep walking.
Stupid. Hey, man. Come on, man. Girls these days don't even know how to act. Boy, you trying to get to know them. You want to act all crazy.
Imagine not being able just to walk down the street.
Citizens, we cannot escape history. Today, in this room, under the watchful eye of President Abraham Lincoln, by a constitutional majority of the members elected to the Illinois General Assembly, and by my actions as governor, we have abolished the death penalty in Illinois, the land of Lincoln.
My story is that I am the first woman who received the death sentence in the state of Illinois. And by now you know that I'm the only woman ever who has walked out of an Illinois state prison that has been on death row. The story is that I was sentenced to death. The case was called conspiracy to murder. The claim was that I told somebody to kill somebody, which was not true. They know that I wasn't at the scene of crime. They know that I did not kill anybody. They sentenced me to death on basically hearsay evidence that somebody said I told them to go and get somebody to kill somebody. I was not exonerated. I went all the way with my new attorneys, Mr. Charles Hoffman and Mr. He's now a federal judge, Matthew Canelli, and we fought all the way through the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court overturned my sentence.
I'm a mother that lost a son. I'm a mother that lost a son that was gunned down. I'm a mother who lost a son that participated in killing another lady's child, too. And even though one was accidental, it still happened. It doesn't feel good being a mother because my child cannot come and enjoy family dinners or family functions we have, or, you know, I can't see him when I want to. If he's sick, I can't be there for him, you know, to, you know, doctor on him, or, you know, just call him anytime I want to. So as a mother, I don't have that anymore, but I'm thankful at the same time because I still can hear his voice. I still can go see him as a mother.
Illinois has a broken system that is too flawed to fix. We have a problem with innocence. We found 20 innocent people on death row. The death penalty in Illinois harms murder victims' families.
We end up sending people to death row who shouldn't be there, either because of a mistaken identification. Even people who are well-intentioned can make a mistake and say that person did it when actually somebody else did it. But you also see police officers and prosecutors who believe they have the right person, and they cut corners and they hide evidence, and they do other corrupt things to get people on death row.
Right now, it takes an average of 10 to 15 years from when the gavel comes down to when someone is sentenced, until someone is executed. And here in Illinois, we've had a moratorium for the last 11 years. So a moratorium basically means that the government is putting something on hold. Many times they do this to study something. Here in Illinois, there's a moratorium on executions, which means we are not executing anyone that's currently on death row. It does not mean that we've gotten rid of the death penalty. For the last 10 years, we have been sending people to death row, and currently there's 15 people on death row.
There's no way that we can devise a death penalty system that's only going to convict guilty people and is only going to send people to death row who deserve the death penalty.
We found out that the death penalty is millions of dollars more expensive than any other sentencing option in Illinois.
Well, the situation that happened with my cousin Darian, he got killed. He was beat to death actually on the south side. They got most of the boys that were involved in the situation. I feel that they should be in death penalty because they took his life away over something that could have been solved differently. And other people may feel or think different of me, but I just feel that it was wrong and they should be punished.
I got a cousin that killed somebody like around 04. And right now he is serving 25 years to life. And like with the death penalty, you don't get that joy of seeing that person ever again. But like to this day, because my cousin got that 25 years, his mother go see him at least once a month and she get the joy of seeing her son.
When we hurt people, when we destroy minds, when we destroy men and fathers and mothers, we're destroying children.
Everybody had their own opinion. Some people may agree, some people may not agree. I feel that the people who take people's lives should be in death penalty.
To me, when you take another person's life, even though it's through the death penalty, you're the same as that person that murdered the person, because you're pulling the switch or you're injecting that gas, that stuff into that person's arms, or you're pulling the switch to let the gas in the room. So to me, I'm against it.
Well, race plays a role in just about every aspect of the criminal justice system. Race also plays a huge role in the death penalty, and the way it plays out in the death penalty is the race of the victim.
It is more likely if you are a black person who has killed a white person, you're more likely to get the death penalty than a white person who kills a person of color.
And I think that's largely because jurors tend to identify with the victims in crime, and most jurors in death penalty cases are white people, and they believe that the life of a white person is more valuable than the life of a person of color.
They created an old burned out cement block room, and that's where they threw me. My definition of justice is a level playing field. You can't get justice when corrupt is judging corrupt.
Well, my definition of justice would be something, it would have to be something that's, you know, swift and sure. And that's really where my problem with the death penalty comes up. You know, in Illinois, you know, we've gotten it wrong 20 times. We've only had 12 executions in the state since 1976. So if that's the ratio, we clearly can't get it right.
Retributive justice, which is what the courts usually deal in, and what that means is that if a person commits a crime, they're punished and taken away from society. Retribution is meted out for what they did. There's also restorative justice, which rather than just punishing the person, tries to make the victim whole, tries to make the victim back where they were before the crime happened, and also tries to show the person who broke the law the error of their ways and rehabilitate them.
Our opposition is primarily that says that the death penalty is a deterrent and that it's needed for murder victims' families to have closure. Both of those we've proven not to be true.
I went to death row in 1990, in the 90s. And if you look at the statistics between then and now, there is no deterrent.
We cannot assure that we won't get the wrong person.
The system is exactly what it is. A system, a beast.
I just don't think that it's right to kill people, regardless of the reason, and especially I don't think the state should be in the business of killing people.
There's other options out there where we have to talk about prison release. We need to talk about what is the right sentence for the right crime.
If you take a life, you're no better than the person that took a life.
It also kind of sets the wrong message. If we're so worried about our government, why are we giving them the power to kill? Death row is tough, but life without parole is tougher. You know, to know that every day this is going to be your life and there's no way out, this is a much harsher punishment. Look, if you want to be tough on crime, send somebody a life without parole, because death row, they're getting off somewhat easy.
Having worked in the death penalty for about 30 years, I see that the death penalty really doesn't do what death penalty proponents say it's supposed to do.
I never looked at the state as my enemy. I looked at the state as a entity that need to get it right. So I just knew they were gonna get it right. This is some type of mirage. It's gonna happen, they're gonna find the truth, they're gonna know it's right, but they didn't. My execution date was set for May 20th, 1990. Even in the face of that, most people would have committed suicide or did whatever. But because I knew I had never killed anybody, because I knew I hadn't violated God, I was determined to look my enemy in the face one day and say, still I rise.
In this year alone, in Chicago, we've had 34 Chicago public school students gunned down and killed. In this year alone. And for the most part, there has been silence. We know what to do. It's already been mentioned. We've got to enforce the gun laws that are on the books. We've got to make sure that unscrupulous gun dealers aren't loading up vans and dumping guns in our communities, because we know they're not made in our communities.
When I see this dude, I see his life as a struggle. His life was the balls that clowns juggle. This guy could have been and done so much. He has done stupid things just because he was touched. But he did try with me. When I see this dude, I see a smart young man raised in the wrong household. His daddy teaches him to be like him. Don't take no shit and be bold. He was raised to carry a gun so nobody would get him. He thought he'd never have to run because he'll shoot him. This guy ain't even 16 yet, and he have to wear a bulletproof vest. When I see this guy, I see his so-called father that raised him to be tough. He taught his son to put your woman in line, even if he had to get rough. He seen his mama get hit by his daddy and thinks it's all right. He says, hey, she pushed him, and he was right to want to fight. When I see this dude, I see a teen that has been to jail more than 3 times already. This boy has been shot multiple times and almost was headless, dead. This boy is smart and don't go to school because it will make him look like a fool. His other friends tell him it ain't cool. When I see this dude, I see my close friend going in the wrong path. He will end up in jail or in a bloodbath. Why is his father, the so-called chief, is keeping him in all his beef? I'm the only one that cares, he thinks, so he wastes his life on violence, weed, and drinks. Who will help this guy? The government? His family? His home? Because I can't do this alone.
I'm Tiffany Moore.
And I'm Michael Ingram.
And this is your HoopsHIGH Halftime Show.
Watch it or watch nothing.
If you stay at school, this is where you will be. This is where you'll be if you stay focused and stay in school.
Made it! I graduated!
I wish I would have graduated.
You should stay in school. Get your education. Education is very important. You kids are going to want money, jobs, and a successful life. So you should stay in school and get your education.
Stay in school, kids! Education is very important.
Education is extremely important to students or to anybody because there's this link between education and freedom. And so if you have an education in the society we live in today, you have more freedom to do what you want with your life.
Well, education never ends. Education is about learning, it's about growing, it's about becoming fully informed about whatever realm you want. So in life, I think it's a huge spectrum of things that you're being educated about.
Okay, so education is this process of learning. And so in order to define education, I have to define learning. And learning is your ability to acquire skills and learn and grow in those skills over time.
Education never ends. So in life, to be successful, you need to be educated about whatever topic is important to you. So it could be social interactions. You need to know how to relate to people if you want to be successful in a job or successful in school. If you want to be a lawyer, you have to be educated on the particular skills about law and how to be prepared. In most any field nowadays, to be successful, you need to know how to write, how to communicate, how to do research, how to synthesize information. So those are some clear values, and they can apply anywhere. And so you need those things to be successful. Without them, it's hard to be successful in so many ways.
So if a student doesn't finish school or doesn't finish high school or doesn't take that chance to go on to college, it's hard to say because each individual is different, but they'll find themselves in a harder situation than a person with an education. They'll find it harder to do what they want to do with their life than somebody who does have an education.
I think every person is unique in their own journey. They're going to travel it as it seems fit. As I said earlier, education never ends. So if you are just don't learn anything, then you're probably never going to get off your bed and you're going to sit in your mom's basement for life.
Seems too high, and you don't have the courage nor the strength to climb.
Education is a social process. Education is growth. Education is a preparation for life. Education is life itself.
Absolutely inequality in school funding.
There's no question, there definitely in America is an inequality in school funding.
I do think there is inequality in school funding.
I do believe that there is inequality in school funding.
I think there are inequalities in education.
People get ready for that train to Jordan, picking up passengers.
Is the allocation of taxes for it, and that local funding is a dominant source. Another cause is just it's just political will, in that some of the towns that are well funded don't really want to change the situation; it works for them, and the towns that are poor don't have enough political clout to change things.
Formula. I mean, it's the way funding is devised right now for schools. That makes it unequal.
And I think it has to do with the socioeconomic level, the neighborhoods, tax base, things like that. It also has to do probably with fundraising from other sources as to who in the community might have resources to give to a school that in some neighborhoods wouldn't be a potential donor, a potential source of funding.
The area isn't as, you know, wealthy as other areas. The taxes and things don't provide for us like other schools.
It all goes back to when I dropped out of school, having fun, I was living the life. Now I got a problem with that little white.
Illinois, and in a lot of states across the country, is it's funded through local taxes. So it's based on taxes in Chicago, taxes in Lake Forest. They fund most of the schools. So if you live in a town that's really wealthy and has a lot of tax money, you have more money in schools. If you live in a town that's very poor, maybe Harvey or someplace, they have a lot less money for schools. And so right off the bat, you have some places that spend $15,000 a kid, and other places that spend about $7,000.
And higher tax base get more money for their schools, whereas lower income neighborhoods get less money for their schools. So in a way, it's you would think that neighborhoods which need more help, more support, actually get less money coming in. In the neighborhoods that already have a lot of wealth, more of that money goes to their schools. So,
the situation right now with low-income housing, you can't really prevent it, but it is a problem when it comes to school funding.
Neighborhood based on employment, based on the education of the parent, the schools are funded.
Often what happens is because schools are funded through real estate taxes, if there is not enough taxes coming from the various homes in the area, then the schools don't get as much as other neighborhoods where there's more real estate taxes coming in for schooling.
If I live in an area that, you know, has a lot of low-income homes, like low-income homes, then it won't be as much money put into like the school.
A lot of the other schools do get more funding because of the area they're in. We get less.
So where the wealth is, that's where the funding will be for the schools. And unfortunately, if you look at an area like the west side of Chicago, the people that own the property are not the residents in those areas.
Schools that are underfunded might hire a new teacher right out of school. They're cheaper than hiring the best possible teacher who might cost twice or maybe even three times as much. So schools are making decisions based on money rather than what's right for kids. You're going to have an impact in test scores.
Your teachers, some have to go to just poverty schools because they want to, for one, save money on loans. Like, it's a grant that you can get that you won't have to pay back if you teach in the urban schools.
It's a tough question to answer.
From a social conscious perspective, you know, we have to say, is this the best we can do for children? And I don't think it is.
You couple limited funds within schools and limited resources within schools, you'll probably find that lower test scores could be associated with the limited resources and the limited funding within some schools.
Schools have more money, then there's more resources available for the kids to be exposed to things, to have various experiences, to be exposed to various kinds of information. And that stores up a wealth of knowledge over time. And then when it comes time to take standardized tests, then it translates into higher test scores.
Because the funding is directly related to exposure to testing materials, exposure to the top quality books, exposure to field trips, exposure to every aspect of education. Funding is directly related.
Quality teachers, quality administration. And unfortunately, many times it's hard for urban environments to get all three of those different things, the quality programming, the quality teachers, and the quality administration, and get those people to work together in collaboration.
Schools that don't have enough funding, and just think of lost opportunities. I think of years of programs that may not have been available because of underfunding. And so then, so I can think of individual kids with lost opportunities, and then you make that across a statewide level and you make it over 20 or 30 years, and it's millions of people who have different, exposed to different things. And if they have reduced test scores, that might close doors to college scholarships and college opportunities. And so I just think of lives that haven't been able to necessarily fulfill themselves always.
At some point, all of America's children are all of our children, and it benefits everyone to give an equitable education to everyone.
Individual efforts to bring in funding from private donors. That's kind of on the low level. On the upper level, it may translate into more of a political situation where we would have to call upon our public officials to do more for schools like ours, not just ours, but other schools, other.
You know, we need legislators who are willing to step up to the box and say, we're going to do this differently, and I think this is, you know, and here's what I'm proposing that we do.
If they have the resources to, you know, put more funds behind a particular program, that they have either researched as best practice, and they're able to say, if we, you know, implement this, we know it costs, you know, $20,000 additional funding, but we have it. Let's do it. We know it's going to bring our scores up.
Things like smaller class sizes are important. Early intervention for people with learning problems is important. One-on-one tutoring is essential. So people taking research-based solutions, figuring out a good program to address these problems, and then funding it. So we need money, but we also need a plan.
Francisco, man, what up, food, nah. Got fried in this bed.
Yeah, I got fried.
Where
you going to class?
Oh, man, I'm finna go get fried.
Hey, where you going?
You going to class?
No,
you ain't, man.
You
finna come with us. We finna get you hot.
You finna get
you hot
today.
Majority of teens today aren't influenced in a good way. Teens today do not realize that their social environment won't get them far. Don't follow me.
It stirs.
L'Shea, Shanaz, Amos, Aaron, Brown, Scourge. Have you ever been discouraged?
We saw a problem among our African American males being discouraged and decided to find causes of their discouragement.
Our African American young male now, they're blaming on society, they're blaming on the school, they're blaming on everybody but themselves.
Well, I think outcomes are based on environment also. So what individuals see all the time, they think that this is the outcome for me. You know, these are people who look like me, you know, been through what I've through, and this is all I see of them. Then I think I'm headed down that same road. So as far as African American males, I think we have the most negative images and things being portrayed of them, which could lead to them being discouraged, especially if there are not things to lift them up.
The message that they are receiving here and the message that they are receiving at home often is like two different messages. Well, we are pushing the education, we're pushing for them to go to college and to be their best and to, you know, to try to do their best. They may not be getting the same message here in school.
Like, I get a lot of support from my father and, you know, family, other people in my family, and I get also examples.
I mean, this weekend, you know, we're coming back from being downstate, the first charter school ever to get downstate in boys basketball, and a lot of the young men could have been discouraged because, you know, it looked as if it wasn't, you know, calls wasn't being made fairly. And, you know, you especially those seniors and other individuals on the team could have felt like, you know, this, it was taken away from them. And that could lead to long-time discouragement. In moments you are discouraged, you need to look deeper into that particular situation to find out, you know, did I actually do everything that I could have done? And so when we go through our long periods of being discouraged, I think we should really do some reflecting.
But it takes a man to raise another man. So I think if we have more male teachers, more African American males would be more involved in school instead of discouraged.
Because the people make the neighborhood, you know, so I don't think it's the neighborhood. You know, I think they're afraid to get out of the neighborhood because, you know, they've been in it so long. You know, it's just like a good job. You've been at a good job so long, you don't want to leave. You know, it's just like if you've been, you know, you going to a nice restaurant and it's how you having fun, you don't want to leave. You know, if somebody else ready to leave, you're like, man, I don't want to leave right now, I want to stay. You know, if you get, you know, immune to some of your environment, you want to stay. But if you get tired of it, you know, you want to leave. You know, but I think it'll take time. Some people just have to wake up. It takes something for somebody to move around, for somebody to wake up. Like, it'll take a bullet for somebody to wake up, somebody to go to jail, you know, for you to wake up. A loss in the family for you to wake up actually, you know, look and see what your environment is and see do you really want to be here or not.
So we ran across the street on Sir Mac and Dre. And then about like 2 minutes later, just like you saw us a purple van just ride by and they just started shooting at us and stuff like that. So I felt like that my life was in jeopardy. We didn't get shot, but two other guys got shot.
Majority of times when there is a youth-related homicide, youth-related violent incident, it's with a handgun.
This documentary is about dangerous events in Chicago's South and West Side communities. These events are all personal experiences of those involved in the production of this film, and the intention is to raise awareness in hopes that residents in these communities can avoid dangerous situations.
I was with my cousin, and we was shopping. And on the way home, as we got near the house, this man jumped out of the car. Well, I ain't gonna say a man, I don't know what he was, but this person jumped out of the car and he asked for our bags and we gave it to him. But this dummy decided that he shot the gun three times, but twice it didn't work and the third time it did.
You're not made of steel. You're a human being just like everybody else. You have feelings, you have emotions, you have fears. Just like the next person. So everything that you experience affects you. Even though it doesn't happen to you directly, it still affects you. And you still take it on with you.
We was walking from my auntie house to go to the restaurant. Some boys ran up with a gun. They caught us or whatever. He shot in the air first. Friend JT swung on one of the boys. He got shot in the head 6 times and he got shot in the chest 3 times.
During the weeks of March 3, 2006 and March 11, 2006, two young girls were fatally shot by stray bullets in the privacy of their own homes. March 3, 2006, 14-year-old Starkeisha Reed was shot and killed while sitting in the window preparing for school. March 11, 2006, 10-year-old Sarita White was shot and killed celebrating at her surprise birthday party just 2 days before her 11th birthday.
As you know, when something does happen in the community, it isn't just that one person that's bothered or affected by it. It's the community entire. As you know, these two girls that were slain over the last 2 weeks affects us all. It doesn't just affect that one girl who was shot. It affects the Inglewood and the entire city collectively. It's devastating. It's devastating to know that that families feel the fear in their own homes.
I pay attention to my surroundings now. When I'm walking, I don't walk slow. When I'm by myself, I just change a lot of things.
Stay out of parties. You shouldn't go to parties in an environment where you don't really know a lot of people at.
But I always tell young people that if their mind tells them that it's wrong, then 95% of the time it's wrong. You know, if your mind tells you not to go down that dark street, don't go down that dark street.
I just tell them to beware of their surroundings, like know where you at and who's been watching you and stuff like that. Cause to me, I feel like this man or this person that did it was had to been watching us from the beginning. So I just say know your surroundings.
Stay away from certain people that you know that's doing wrong. Because it'll lead to death, life or death situation.
It's a lot of different things put together that need to be addressed in order to, I think, curb the violence in society.
Hi, I'm Karen Jordan, and you're watching FSM News.
Hello, and welcome to FSM News. I'm Matthew Ross.
And I'm Dakota Brown. FSM News is a product of Free Spirit Media, which is a non-profit organization which empowers youth voice.
At the Adler Planetarium, there are many types of shows, exhibitions, and daily activities to explore.
Interns at Adler are creating an app that helps visitors move smoothly through their exhibits. Here's Janila McKinney with the new design.
Interns at the Adler Planetarium are exploring augmented reality as a way to enhance the perception of the real world.
We take the existing reality and we use the technology to view amplified images of it, whether there's like art on top of it or animations or just as a different world. We're changing or augmenting the space around us.
To view this cool feature, grab your iPod, iPhone, or iPad. Go to camera and hold it over the See Art Here sign. Here at the Adler Planetarium, teen interns are creating a cool mobile app to take you on a tour of all of the exhibits.
Depending on your interests, you get to pick whether you're into highlights or classic Adler or the deep science of it all.
The interns are also brainstorming ideas to create the new app.
So far, my input has been collect content and to map out the tours, and right now we're trying to build them.
They are honored to work with the Adler program.
I just thought it was really cool. Like, what other teenager in Chicago can say like they get to help the Adler with social media or build an app?
The program teaches them skills that they can share with others.
What I hope that all of my interns have this summer is the ability and the empowerment to share what they're creating through the technology platforms we're working with, and to take everything that they've been making this summer. They've been very production oriented, and be able to share that with their communities.
Reporting for FSM News, I'm Janila McKinney.
It's amazing how the youth are given the opportunity to be part of public radio.
Up next on our Did You Know statement, we introduce you to a radio program that informs teens on social issues.
Stay tuned. Welcome back. Thanks for staying with us.
Did you know that Radio Arte is a youth-driven radio station that works to advance the voices of everyone in society?
Here's Jeremiah Booz with more interesting facts.
Did you know that Radio Arte offers a bilingual one-year media training program to hundreds of youth ages 15 to 21? They train young adults in journalism to tackle social justice issues. They also encourage the youth to shed light on community matters that are sometimes missed in mainstream media. Reporting from FSM News, I'm Jeremiah Booz.
We're not done telling you everything that Radio Arte does. This organization teaches teens how to produce radio segments.
Here's Jamie Still with more.
Radio Arte is a public radio station that is located in the Pilsen neighborhood. This station is unique in many ways.
What we do is we have to have an audio piece for about 2 minutes long, but also the article as well, talking about our beats. For example, I have art and I'm working with somebody in music.
Radio Arte teens focus on media training by learning audio and producing techniques. They also learn to write and edit scripts.
We all had a specific topic and we were paired with somebody who doesn't have the exact same topic, but it's something close. Right now we're working on listening to it, picking out our favorite quotes, and trying to put stuff in order.
Radio Arte not only teaches teens to produce radio and audio pieces, they're dedicated to important issues not often told by the mainstream media.
The city of Chicago as a media landscape has lost a lot of neighborhood newspapers, and as a consequence, I think a lot of voices go unheard. So our youth try to identify those missing voices and sort of see the value in where they grew up and experiences they've been through, and try to apply that as being a reporter or being a storyteller.
This program allows teens to prepare for professional radio production and gain strong insight of the community.
I thought it was a great opportunity for me to know a little bit better about my community, especially when it was in my community.
Since 1997, Radio Arte has offered a chance for the youth to discover the importance of media. Reporting from FSM News, I'm Jamie Stubbs.
Coming up, Find out why many people are staying at the Adler Planetarium overnight.
You won't want to miss this. Stay with us.
Did you ever think it would be possible to spend a night at the museum? Well, now you can visit the Adler Planetarium's newest exhibit called the Astro Overnights. This exhibit offers an interactive experience. You can dream of landing on the moon, exploring the surface of Mars, and shooting past asteroids. To take part in this adventure, register online at the Adler Planetarium's website. So feel free to check it out.
Welcome back. Thanks for staying with us.
Project Exploration was created to help minority students find their interest in science.
The program does just that and so much more. Here's Imani Winston with the story.
The science media team are working on building a bridge between the science world and media.
The science media team is us taking all that passion for like discovery and doing real science and putting that into the news arena.
The students participate in workshops that they really enjoy.
People making the effort, taking the time, you know, putting in all what you know, all these efforts, and you know, coming here every morning, trying to make science interesting to me is what, you know, really brought it out in me. I'm like, you know what, science, you know, it has a place in my life.
The teens got the chance to work with multiple science professionals.
To learn about what they do and how they answer these big questions that no one even thinks about. And we learn about new things every day.
The instructor is glad that her students are publishing important science stories.
Science media team is kind of attacking that issue. It's young people of color talking about science issues that matter.
Some members of the team shared their favorite science topics.
I'm really interested in astronomy. I've had a chance before to kind of work with NASA and Kepler. So astronomy is really great.
During their science week, the team were exposed to different types of science professions and were even given the opportunity to possibly have their articles published. Reporting from FSM News, I'm Amane Winston.
Well, it's time for us to wrap up this week's newscast, but we'll be back next week on FSM News on the Road.
Until then, check us out on Facebook. Search FSM News.
And also check us out on ABC7 Chicago's website under the community section. Have a great week in 3, 2, 1, that's a wrap.
Good, let's do it one more time. Just.